The Elijah Lovejoy Monument, erected here in Alton, Illinois, and dedicated on November 8, 1897, the 60th anniversary of his death. It took a little while to get everyone on board.
The Reverend Elijah Parrish Lovejoy was pastor of a Presbyterian church and publisher of the St. Louis Observer. As a white man who witnessed a mob burning a slave at the stake, he was called to conscience and published editorials in his paper advocating the abolition of slavery. Citizens of the slave state of Missouri responded by attacking the Observer's offices and destroying his press.
Reverend Lovejoy decided to move his family and business to the safety of Alton in the free state of Illinois. However, when a boat carrying his press up the Mississippi arrived in July 1836, a group of men boarded the ship, broke up the press, and threw the pieces into the river.
Alton's most prominent businessmen provided Lovejoy with the support to purchase a new press and establish the Alton Observer.
On the night of August 21st, 1837, Reverend Lovejoy was confronted by a mob who entered the office of the Observer and destroyed the new press.
And when a third press arrived only a month later, a dozen men with their faces covered broke apart the new press and again tossed the remains into the Mississippi.
When a fourth press was ordered, a committee of citizens gathered and passed a resolution that Lovejoy stop publishing and leave Alton.
Lovejoy responded by addressing the body.
Why should I flee from Alton? Is this not a free state? The very act of retreating will embolden the mob to follow me wherever I go. No, sir, there is no way of escaping the mob but to abandon the path of duty, and that, God helping me, I will never do.
The night after the fourth press arrived, a mob of armed and drunken men threatened Lovejoy and his supporters guarding the press.
When the mob set fire to the warehouse, Lovejoy and two supporters went outside to extinguish the flames, but members of the mob fired their guns, and Lovejoy was hit 5 times.
While Lovejoy breathed his last, the vigilantes broke apart the printing press and once again threw the pieces
into the dark waters of the Mississippi. 2 days later, on what would have been his 37th birthday, Elijah Lovejoy was laid to rest.
The national outrage over Reverend Lovejoy's assassination proved to be a turning point in garnering support for the movement to abolish slavery.
Just months later, a young Abraham Lincoln alluded to Lovejoy's murder in a speech at the Springfield Lyceum.
Whenever the vicious portion of population shall be permitted to gather in bands of hundreds and thousands, burn churches, ravage and rob provision stores, throw printing presses into rivers, shoot editors, hang and burn obnoxious persons at pleasure and with impunity, depend on it, this government cannot last.
Hard times came to Alton in the years after Lovejoy's murder. The economy collapsed, property values fell, and businesses moved away. Some attributed the city's struggles to the ignominy that resulted from the actions of the Alton mob.
So 60 years later, on November 8, 1897, at the base of this grand memorial, we invited, as an act of unification, all citizens of Alton to gather together to dedicate this monument.
But some citizens chose not to attend the dedication ceremony.
Because this grand sculpture was not the first edifice in Alton that was dedicated to honor Reverend Lovejoy that year.
In September of 1897, just 2 months before the dedication of the monument, the Alton Board of Education opened 2 new schools.
One named for the black abolitionist leader, Frederick Douglass, and the other for Alton's white martyr to the cause, Elijah Parrish Lovejoy.
These schools were built despite the 1870 Illinois Constitution and subsequent statutes providing for free public schools for all children. In particular, the statute passed in 1874.
Mm-hmm. That reads, all boards of school directors, boards of education, or school officers are prohibited from excluding, directly or indirectly, any such child from such school on account of the color of such child.
Mm. 2 new schools built to segregate our colored children into separate schools.
Schools named for Frederick Douglass and Elijah P. Lovejoy.
The actions of the sworn officials of the city disrupt the 2-decade practice of integrated schools in Alton.
These offenses galvanize the African American citizens of Alton, who respond with
sit-ins, boycotts,
and a series of 7 trials from 1898 to 1908. that resulted in two hung juries and five decisions that rise to appeal in the Supreme Court of the state of Illinois.
The lawsuits were brought in the name of Scott Bibb,
a father and a fireman at the Alton Glass Works.
At the first trial, a jury of 12 found that the officials had not acted illegally.
So Scott Bibb appealed the decision,
which was heard at the Illinois Supreme Court in 1899.
Oyez, oyez, the Honorable Supreme Court of Illinois is called to order. This action is brought by the people on the relation of Scott Bibb for a writ of mandamus.
A writ or order that is issued from a higher tier court that commands a lower tier court, corporation, municipal corporation, or individual to perform or refrain from performing a particular act, the performance or omission of which is required by law as an obligation.
A writ of mandamus against the mayor and members of the Common Council of the City of Alton to compel them to admit the children of the relator to the Washington School or the most convenient of the public schools of said city to which they have the right to be admitted without excluding them or either of them on account of their color or descent.
Records indicate that the testimony at the seven trials was essentially the same. The roster of witnesses varied little, and the content of their testimony was consistent.
The presentation of the testimony you will hear tonight is selected from the 1904, 1906, and 1908 trial testimony, briefs, and judicial decisions.
While the testimony and arguments quote from the written record, we will also, for the sake of clarity and brevity, use exchanges outside of the courtroom that we have invented based on the known facts and circumstances of these events.
Sources include quotations from newspapers of the day, representing the voices of both the white and African-American communities.
In particular, the Illinois Record, published in Springfield by the Afro-American League. Its weekly column with news from Alton united the black community throughout the state by providing information often ignored by the mainstream press.
Some of the language of our time may fall hard on your contemporary ears, but it is preserved to convey the tenor of the times.
And two times, we've replaced a word we just didn't see the need for.
The initial witness called was the relator.
The individual upon whose complaint the proceedings are called.
Scott Bibb.
Questioned initially by his attorney.
John J. Brenhold.
A former mayor of Alton.
And the only prominent white of the city on record supporting the efforts to fight the segregation of the schools.
How old are you, Mr. Bibb?
I am 49 years old.
And how long have you lived in Alton?
Well, ever since 1863, when I first come to Alton.
Of what parentage were you born?
Colored.
I will ask you, Mr. Bibb, if you were a slave.
I was.
I will ask you if you are married.
Yes, sir.
What is your wife as to color?
She is a colored lady.
Are you the party that filed the petition in this case?
Yes, sir, I am.
I will ask you now to state what you know, if anything, with regard to your children, Ambrose and Minnie Bibb, attending the school in the city of Alton in September 1897.
I sent them to the Washington School, and they were refused admission. They came back home with a card assigning them to go to the Lovejoy School.
Who had the card?
Ambrose had the card. He is my son. Mm-hmm. And I sent him back to the Washington School where he formerly went to, and he came back home. I went with him the next morning to see what the trouble was. I met Mr. Laughlin there. He was in the habit of working at the Illinois Glass Company where I work. He was a policeman. He told me he didn't care to come up there to that old schoolhouse because I sent my children there. We were old friends and we worked together. But he told me that he had to do this. He was ordered to do it. He said, Scott, I hate to turn my back on you, but I have to do it. I am ordered here by Mayor Brueggemann to keep the coloreds out of the public schools. Mm-hmm.
Did he say where the colored children should go?
Well, they wanted to send my boy to the Lovejoy School, the one nearest of the two new schools. But I went back to the Washington School for 2 weeks in succession. I worked nights at the glassworks firing, and I had the opportunity to go over there every morning from my work. And every morning I went there, I met the police at the schoolhouse who were there to keep the colored children out. Mm.
What children went into the Washington school while you were there those 2 weeks?
The white children went in because the police kept the colored children out.
How far is the Lovejoy School from your house?
About a mile and a half.
How far is the Washington School from your house?
About 3 blocks away.
What school would your children have to pass to get to the Lovejoy or Douglas School?
They would have to pass right by the Washington School.
The witness was cross-examined by
Elliot Breeze Glass,
the attorney defending the Alton officials. A graduate of Shirtliff College, Glass had served as state's attorney, mayor of Edwardsville, and president of the Edwardsville Board of Education.
Were you there the first morning that these children of yours received the cards?
No, sir. I was not there.
Then all you know about that is what you have been told.
Well, I went over there the second morning.
Now, the first morning you went there was considerable excitement going on about the schoolyard?
No, sir. There was not. Just me and the police and a couple of the neighbors who came in to see about their children.
Isn't it a fact that most of the people who were there that morning, talking with the police and the young scholars about the schoolhouse, were colored people?
No. There were a good many white people there, a neighboring white people around there.
Did your children go to any of the two schools known as Lovejoy or Douglas schools?
The Washington school was the nearest school.
Please, answer my question. Did your children ever go to any of the two schools known as Lovejoy or Douglas schools?
No, sir.
Why not?
Because I didn't intend to send them to that school, Mr. Glass.
Why didn't you intend to send them there?
Because it was a mile out of the way. And as I said, I wasn't going to send them there.
Why would the city council throw out a school system that's been doing just fine for 25 years? Our kids have been in classrooms with the white children almost since the end of the Civil War.
I think it's because they're trying to sell houses over here to white folks from St. Louis. But when they hear our schools are integrated, they run right off.
Well, the principal said it's because there's not enough space in the building.
Well, there's an empty room upstairs at the Washington School. Mm-hmm. I went up and looked.
They want to make it separate but equal? You think it's a coincidence the Alton City Council passed the ordinance to change the school district just 3 months after the U.S. Supreme Court gave segregation the okay? Mm-hmm.
Plessy versus Ferguson? But wasn't that about train cars?
They mentioned schools in their opinions. Pretty much approved it. Mm-hmm. And just 3 months later, the mayor made plans to segregate the schools here. I don't think that's a coincidence. Mm-mm.
And Harry Coates said,
those new schools aren't as good as any of the other schools in Alton, by one half.
Does the city want to annex Upper Alton?
Pie Town, they segregated their high school back in 1886.
Yeah, don't expect they'd join Alton if our schools stay integrated.
But that case went to the Illinois Supreme Court in 1889. They said it was against the Illinois law to segregate the school.
Mm-hmm. Didn't seem to change their way of doing things in Upper Alton.
Same up in McLean County. 8th Judicial District said that the school district couldn't build a new school for only four black children.
That's right.
They did it anyway. Case went up on the Illinois Supreme Court in 1874. Mm-hmm. Court said that school was illegal.
The state legislature passed the act to protect colored children in their rights to attend public schools to stop those Jim Crow schools.
Over in Quincy, 1882, the Illinois Supreme Court said their rule requiring all colored pupils attend their own school violated just that statute. This is what the court said. Whether our Illinois Constitution and the acts of the legislature passed in pursuance of it, which place all children, regardless of color, upon a perfect equality so far as admission into the public schools is concerned, are to be regarded as wise or unwise legislation, is a matter with which courts have no concern. We are bound to declare the law as we find it written, and if it is not satisfactory to any section of the state, the remedy is in the legislative department of the government, and there alone.
That's strong words.
Did it change anything?
Some, but they still got a black school there. Oh.
Please state your name for the court.
Ambrose Bibbs, my name, Mr. Brenholt.
What is your age?
I'll be 16 my next birthday.
Whereabouts in what vicinity do you live of the Washington Schoolhouse?
Oh, I live 3 blocks northeast of there.
And how long have you lived in that place?
All my life.
I will ask you, how many of your family attended the Washington School in September 1897 or attempted to attend?
Two.
Who was the other?
My sister, Minnie Bibb.
And what grade was she in?
The second grade.
And how old was she at the time?
Well, I was 9 years old, so she was 7 years old at the time.
What pupils went to the Washington School prior to 1897 with you, if you know, as to color?
Whites and blacks both.
Have you the school admission card in your pocket?
Yes, sir.
I will ask you where you obtained this card.
My teacher, Miss Mary Crawford.
When?
June 1897.
And what was the purpose of this card if she said something to you?
That admitted me to a higher grade in the fall.
I will ask you, what other children got those cards, if you know, at the Washington School?
All those in my room got those cards.
Well, who got them with reference to color?
Whites and blacks both got them.
I will ask you now what you did, if anything, with reference to attending Washington School in September 1897.
Well, we went there, my sister Minnie and I, that first day.
What did you do and see there?
Well, we were permitted to enter the schoolroom, and we were given new cards assigning us to the Lovejoy School.
What did you do on the second day?
We went back to the Washington School.
What happened?
We were given permission to the schoolroom, and the teacher there told us we would have to go to the school assigned to us on the cards that we were given the day before.
To whom did she give these cards of assignment?
To the colored children.
Mm. How many did she give to whites, if you know?
I never seen her give any to the whites.
What was the condition of the Washington School as to having room in it when you were there in September 1897?
Well, there was plenty of room in my class.
What did you do the next morning?
We went back.
Now then, what did you find there?
Police officers were there.
Mm. What did they say to you?
They told us we couldn't enter.
What did the policemen do with reference to the white children that came there?
They let them enter the schoolroom.
What did you do next?
We went back the fourth morning, and police officers were there again.
Who went with you to the schoolhouse?
My father.
That's right.
And how many times did he go there?
He went for 3 weeks.
Yes. I returned to the school that my son and daughter had attended so that principals and teachers could see that we had not forgotten nor given up.
Comprising only 7% of the Alton population, we knew we had no power to bring change through the ballot box.
So, we set out to be as visible and vocal as we could. To organize our efforts, the men of the community formed the Alton Citizens Committee and selected Harry B. Coates to be our president.
I have been authorized by the colored citizens to state that we will not attend those segregated schools, and we will contest this matter in the highest courts.
Harry Coates led our group to a meeting in Springfield with the former governor and state senator John Palmer,
who agreed to join Councilor Brandholt in providing legal advice.
We will not abide any illegal scheme. We ask no favor of the board. All we demand is our rights.
We have agreed not to send our children to the segregated public schools, but to teach them at home or in private schools.
If the truant officer should arrest colored people because their children do not attend Douglas and Lovejoy schools, the burden of proof will rest entirely with the Board of Education.
The resolve of the community is so strong that after 3 months, only 15 of our 145 colored children have ignored the boycotts and enrolled in the new schools.
Yes! Yes.
Though our suit was filed in my name, our work required the support of many in our community, both in our organizations and in the courtroom.
Please give your name for the jury.
James Brock.
George Cross.
Robert White.
What is your business?
Barber.
Mr. Cross?
My business at the present time is a smelter at the Federal Lead Company.
Well, at the present time, I'm a saw filer at the Illinois Box Factory. Used to be a sawyer, but I got to be a saw filer a year or so ago.
How many children did you have of school age in September 1897?
Two daughters, Florence and Ella.
One, Raphael.
I will ask you where your children attended school at that time.
My son went to the Washington School.
Garfield.
The Irving School.
How far did you live from that school, Mr. Brock?
4 blocks.
Do you know where the Lovejoy School is?
Yes, sir.
How far did you live from that school?
About 2.5 miles.
What would your children have to cross, if anything, to get to the Douglas School?
They would have to cross the streetcar line on State Street and also on Plaza Street. The O&A. The O&A main line comes down there, and they also have their railroad yards beside the main track.
Mr. Cross, did you ever see police at the school?
Well, I didn't visit the Washington School, but coming home from my work one morning, I passed the Humboldt School. I saw policeman Pack stationed at the entrance of the school gate. He said he was making the colored children go to the schools they were assigned to.
I saw police officers at the Irving School keep our children out during the first week in September. The children marched up in line, and as they come up, the colored children were separated by the whites from the police.
Where did the white children go?
To the white schools where they always went.
What did the officers do with the colored children?
They kept them from going in. They kept them away. Drove them away from the school.
Mr. White, did you ever see or hear, what did you see or hear with reference to your son, Raphael, attending the Garfield School in September 1897?
I took him to Miss Harris, the principal of the school, and asked her if he would be admitted there, and she said no. I asked her why, and she said that according to her directions, no colored children should be admitted to the school. And I insisted on getting an answer. I wanted to know her reasons, and she referred me to Mr. Fink, the president of the Board of Education.
What happened then?
I asked her where Mr. Fink could be found, and she said she didn't know. Well, we found Mr. Fink in the schoolhouse. The Garfield Schoolhouse, we found him, and we had quite a talk with him about it.
Who had quite a talk with him?
Myself and Mr. Cowles and Mr. Jones. We got into quite a conversation with him, probably an hour or an hour and a half. We asked Mr. Fink a great many questions. I wanted to know why my boy wasn't allowed to go to school there. And he told me and the rest there that there had been 2 new schools built for the colored children. And the colored children would have to attend those other 2 schools, the Lovejoy and Douglas schools.
What else did Mr. Fink say to you and Mr. Jones and Mr. Kyles?
When we talked to him, we pressed him for a reason why my child wasn't allowed to go to school there. And one reason he said there wasn't enough room there. I told him there was plenty of room upstairs, lots of vacant seats upstairs. He went up and was gone a little while, and he came back and said, you can send your boy in. The boy went to class and I came away then.
How long did your son continue to go to school there?
I continued to send him there for 2 weeks.
How often did he recite, if you know?
He didn't recite at all.
Mr. Cross, I will ask you if you knew the mayor of Alton.
I knew him when I saw him.
In September 1897, what was his name?
Mr. Henry Brueggemann.
Did you have a conversation with him in reference to the colored children attending public school in Alton?
I met him near the city hall front door, and I asked him why my child and others couldn't be permitted to attend the public schools. He said there were 2 buildings built expressly for colored students, and they would have to go to those 2 schools that they were assigned to. I said I thought it was pretty hard for my child to go there as he has been going to the Washington School. He told me it made no difference. They would have to go there if it required the entire police force to make them go.
Mr. Cross, myself, and Mr. Walker were together when we met Mayor Brueggemann near the City Hall on 2nd Street. Mr. Cross said to him it wasn't hardly right. They were going to those schools together for the last 25 years, and now to separate them, he didn't see any cause for it. Mr. Brueggemann said it made no difference. They must go to the 2 schools built for them.
You may cross-examine Mr. Glass.
Mr. Brock, could white children have gone to these 2 schools known as Douglas and Lovejoy schools and you not know it?
Yes, sir.
You never saw any children of any color prohibited from going to those schools, did you?
No, sir.
Isn't it a fact that the colored children in Alton didn't all have to cross the tracks to go to school? You say about all. What proportion of the colored children have to cross the tracks to go to school?
Some do.
Do you know whether all the children that you spoke of as colored children that were rejected at the Irving School and the Garfield and Washington schools have been going to any school since that time?
Well, some have and some aren't going at all.
Isn't it a fact the majority have been going to public schools
No, sir, not the majority. There's probably one half of them, that's my opinion. Some are going to the Douglas schools, mine are going to the Catholic schools, and some are not going at all.
Mr. Cross, did you send your child to the Lovejoy School afterwards, where he was assigned?
No, sir.
Why didn't you?
Because it was father at the time, and my child was small and not very healthy.
How old was your child?
6 years old.
And 6 or 7 blocks was too far for him to go, in your opinion, to school?
Going from that neighborhood...
Isn't it a fact that the reason you didn't send your child to the Lovejoy School is because you wanted him to go to the Washington School? Was that not the reason?
No, sir. Not the whole reason.
What was the other part of the reason?
Because there were children living in my immediate neighborhood with my child, and they were going back to the same school, and I couldn't understand why my child couldn't go back too.
Well, that means about the same thing, don't it, Mr. Cross?
No, sir.
While the men of the Citizens Committee took the lead in the legal battle for our access to the schools, the women of Alton built the structure to sustain the fight.
Nettie Poindexter established a private school in her home to educate the children during the boycott.
The Ladies Committee was formed to make social arrangements, which served to solidify support for the cause.
The committee's membership provided connections to the community's churches,
such as the African Methodist Episcopal and the Union Baptist,
as well as membership organizations such as the Sisters of the Mysterious Ten and the Order of the Eastern Star.
And through our husbands and our brothers, we reached the members of the United Brothers of Friendship, the Knights of Pythias, and the G.T. Watson Masonic Lodge.
The Ladies' Committee organized dinners, picnics, dances, and riverboat excursions to raise funds to pay the ongoing legal fees.
Our celebrations marked the important events of the year.
The 4th of July.
Emancipation Day.
Trains from Edwardsville, St. Louis, Springfield, and beyond brought African Americans to Alton for the Elijah Love Joy Club's annual parade and picnic.
Come one and all, large and small. Everybody will find comfort simply by putting in their appearance. Mm-hmm. Of course, after the grand concert and cakewalk is disposed of, the accomplished pianist, Miss Cordelia Jones, yes, will take charge of the piano, and you all know the rest.
And that social pool bound the movement together and kept the boycott strong.
If you wanted to attend the dance, you might not be comfortable if you were sending your children to the segregated Lovejoy School. Or taking a job there.
Please state your name for the jury.
Florence Barber.
What is your occupation?
School teacher.
Yeah. At what school?
Lovejoy School.
And what school is that with reference to color?
Red Brick Building.
What is it as to the color of the students that go there?
Oh, well, that is hard to tell.
What are you as to color?
I am colored.
Well, I will ask you, what is the color of the children that you teach at the Lovejoy School?
Well, they are various colors.
Are they not colored children?
Well, that is hard for me to tell, because some have white mothers and some have white fathers.
Yes, are they not called colored children?
As I said before, that is hard for me to tell.
Do any white children go to that school?
I don't know whether they consider them all colored or part white or not.
Will you name all the white children that attend the school you teach, the Lovejoy School?
Well, that I spoke of having mixed blood.
Well, who are they? What are their names?
The Harding children.
Are they not colored?
Well, I don't know how to consider them. Their mother is perfectly white, and their father is colored.
Are they not called colored children?
I can't say.
Isn't it a fact, Miss Barber, that some of the children attending your school from outside appearances are as white as ordinary white persons?
Yes, sir. I have had one case of that in my room.
Thank you.
The plaintiff rests.
To begin, the Alton officials deny the material allegations of discrimination. The Board of Education passed resolutions regarding the organization of the school districts in good faith and to alleviate school overcrowding. For the defense, the city of Alton calls Adolf Fink to the stand. Now, Mr. Fink, what position did you occupy in September in 1897 in the city of Alton?
With reference to the school.
Yes, sir.
I was president of the Board of Education then.
Would you state whether or not, on or about the 20th of September in 1897, you said to Robert White at the Garfield Schoolhouse, there had been two schools built for colored children and they would have to go there, or words to that effect?
No, sir.
Mr. Fink, on or about the 20th day of September, 1897, at the Garfield Schoolhouse in the city of Alton, did you say to David Kiles that he must send his boy to the school built for him, or words to that effect?
I didn't know him at all.
On or about the 20th day of September, 1897, at the Garfield School, did you say to David Kiles that you insist the colored children should go to the colored school?
No, sir.
Now, Mr. Fink, I will ask you to state if about the 20th day of September in 1897, if at your house in the city of Alton, you stated to Messrs. Joyner, Cross, and Coates that the colored children had to go to the colored schools, and the Board of Education had requested the mayor to send the whole police force to do it, or words to that effect?
No, sir.
You may cross-examine.
Mr. Fink, did a committee consisting of Harry Coates, George Cross, Scott Bibb, and William Joyner call on you at your house in Alton in September 1897 with reference to children going to schools in Alton?
Yes, sir.
What conversation did you have with them? Was there any reference to children attending public school in Alton?
Yes, sir.
Did you say to the committee Messrs. Scott Coates, Bibb, and Joyner at the time spoke of that there had been two schools built for colored people, the Lovejoy and Douglas schools, and that they would have to go there?
No, sir.
What? Did you hear the question?
Yes, sir, I heard the question.
Did you meet Robert White at the Garfield School in September 1897?
I don't remember. I don't know White.
Did you have a conversation there in the presence of David Kiles at the time?
I don't know him.
Do you say you did not have a conversation with either Mr. Kiles or Mr. White in the Garfield Schoolhouse with reference to children going to the public school in the city of Alton in September 1897?
No, sir.
I understand you to say you didn't know David Kiles or Robert White.
No, sir. I don't know them personally.
Then how can you say you didn't meet them in the Garfield Schoolhouse in September 1897?
Because I never had any conversations in the Garfield Schoolhouse with any of them.
Well, did you meet any colored men in the Garfield Schoolhouse in September 1897?
I can't remember if I met anyone there or not. I can't remember after 6 years' time has elapsed.
Oh, then you might have met Mr. Kiles and Mr. White and just not remembered it.
I might have. I don't know. I don't remember. I can't tell. I might have met them.
We must stand together and fight those monsters of iniquity whose silence, with the power to act, means our certain ruin. We need money to pay lawyers to advocate our rights in the courts and to bring to justice every man that infringes upon our community school rights.
The Illinois Afro-American Protective League calls on every colored church in the state of Illinois to set apart a Sunday for the purpose of collecting money to aid and assist the Alton people to reestablish the colored children to their constitutional rights.
We're getting along as well as possible, considering the fact that only a faithful few of us have the load to bear.
Mass meetings to raise money to further the Alton school fight are getting to become a common thing in Chicago. You can hear of one every night in some part of the city.
We know positively of $8.35, which was collected by that big committee of 100 citizens in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
but they have yet to turn it over to our Alton committee. Mm.
The citizens of St. Paul contributed $22.45, which shows they have more interest in the welfare of our boys and girls than we have ourselves. The citizens of Alton need money, and we need it bad. And everyone of color in this state should contribute at least 5 cents.
Now, the Alton people are glad to know that our friends elsewhere are taking so much interest in this question.
But that interest comes from all corners. Editorials in the Edwardsville Intelligencer called on John Brinholt to explain his reasons for providing legal counsel for Scott Bibb and urged voters to turn Brinholt out if he chose to stand for re-election to the Illinois Senate.
And the St. Louis Star saluted Henry Brueggemann as the first mayor of Alton who dared to draw the color line.
Mayor Brueggemann, were you the mayor of the city of Alton in September in 1897?
Yes, sir.
I will ask you to state whether or not, in September of 1897, in the city hall or in front of the city hall, you said to James Brock and Alfred Walker and George Cross that there had been two buildings built expressly for colored children and they would have to go there even if it required the whole police force?
No, sir. I never made such a statement.
I will ask you to state whether or not, in the latter part of the month of September in 1897, in your store in the city of Alton, you made the remark that you would send them coloreds to the schools that was built for them if it takes the whole police force. Or words to that effect.
Nope, sir. I did not.
Was David Kyles in your store at any time during the month of September in 1897?
No, sir. I don't think he was. Nor had he been there for several weeks or months before that.
Did you at any time during the month of September in 1897, in the presence of David Kyles in your store, make the remark that was just asked?
In my store?
Yes, sir. Or words to that effect.
No, sir.
Did you ever instruct policemen in Alton, Illinois to prevent the colored children from going to school?
I did not.
Did you at any time order police to go to the schools?
No, sir.
I will ask you to state whether or not you ever issued any orders to the Board of Education with reference to excluding any colored children from the public schools of Alton.
No, sir. I never did issue an order for anything.
Mr. Brinholt,
I understand you to say you didn't have a conversation with George Cross at City Hall in September 1897?
I didn't say I didn't have a conversation with him. I denied the questions as they were put to me. I remember those people stopped to talk to me, but I didn't certainly say more than a word or two and passed on.
Then you did have a conversation with them?
I did.
About school matters?
No, sir. Not about school matters.
In your store in September 1897, didn't you say there that the colored children would have to go to colored schools prepared for them?
No, sir, I didn't say it.
You didn't say that to no one?
Not that I know of.
I understood you to say you never instructed the police to go to the schoolhouse. Well, how did they get there, if you know?
Well, I don't know. I suppose they were directed there by authority.
By what authority?
Well, I don't know. Unless it was the chief of police.
The testimony by these and other witnesses, with no significant difference in evidence presented, was litigated and heard by 7 juries over the course of a decade, with the following results. In a jury trial in the Circuit Court of Madison County in 1898, a jury of 12 returned a unanimous verdict exonerating the Alton officials of violating any Illinois statutes. The verdict was appealed to the Supreme Court of the state of Illinois, where it was heard in 1899. The majority opinion was written by Justice Joseph Carter.
Manifest error prejudicial to Mr. Bibb occurred regarding the admissibility of evidence. The trial court improperly refused to admit evidence that would have supported Mr. Bibb's charge of excluding his children from the Washington school on the basis of race alone.
While it may be that the wisest of both races believe that the best interest of each would be promoted by a voluntary separation in the public schools, and while such voluntary action could not be interfered with by the courts, yet the law is too plain for argument and has often been decided that no child otherwise entitled to attend public school in this state can, on account of the color of that child, be excluded, directly or indirectly, from such school by any school officer or public authority. It is the duty of the mayor and the police to preserve the law. It is no less the duty of the courts to enforce the law as it now stands. The verdict of the jury is set aside, and the Circuit Court of Madison County is directed to
submit the issues to another jury
and to proceed in this case in accordance with the views we have expressed.
At the second jury trial in the Circuit Court of Madison County in 1899, the vote of one juror prevented a unanimous decision exonerating the Alton officials, and the court declared a mistrial with orders for a new trial.
At the third jury trial in the Circuit Court of Madison County in 1900, a jury of 12 returned a unanimous verdict
exonerating the Alton officials
of violating any Illinois statutes.
This verdict was appealed to the Supreme Court of the State of Illinois, where it was heard in December of 1901. With Justice Ricks dissenting, the majority opinion was written by Justice John P. Hand.
The instruction given to the jury by the circuit court stating, if you believe the authorities of the city of Alton have the legal right to assign children to different schools without discrimination to color, your verdict should be in favor of the authorities, improperly ask the jury to find and determine legal propositions. Further, the circuit court improperly submitted to the jury the following question. Do you believe that equal and reasonable educational facilities were furnished to the children of Alton, irrespective of color and without discrimination? Under Illinois law, the city had no right to establish different schools for the white children and the colored children of said city. The verdict is contrary to the manifest weight of the evidence and is against the law. The verdict of the jury is set aside, and the Circuit Court of Madison County is directed to
submit the issues to another jury
and to proceed in the case in accordance with the views we have expressed.
At the fourth jury trial in the Circuit Court of Madison County in 1902, the vote of one juror prevented a unanimous decision
exonerating the Alton officials,
and the court declared a mistrial with orders for a new trial.
At the fifth jury trial in the Circuit Court of Madison County in 1903, a jury of 12 returned a unanimous verdict
exonerating the Alton officials
of violating any Illinois statutes.
The verdict
was appealed
to the Supreme Court of the State of Illinois, where it was heard in April of 1904. The majority opinion was written by Justice James H. Cartwright.
The Alton officials' defense was confined to evidence that they had not declared their intention to violate the statute of the state, nor made a record of their illegal acts in disregard of the law. Whether their denials were true or were due to failing memory or to some other cause or motive, the fact that the intention was not declared does not in any manner affect the rights of the parties. Counsel for the officials can scarcely be serious in insisting there is no evidence of any plan to discriminate. Evidence of the character contained in this record would be accepted by any impartial juror as conclusive, and the verdict can only be accounted for as a product of passion or prejudice. In such case, where the verdict clearly appears to be unsupported by the evidence, it is the duty of the court to set it aside. The verdict of the jury is set aside, and the Circuit Court of Madison County is directed to
submit the issues to another jury
and to proceed in the case in accordance with the views we have expressed.
At the sixth jury trial in the Circuit Court of Madison County in 1904, a jury of 12 returned a unanimous verdict
exonerating the Alton officials
of violating any Illinois statutes.
This verdict
was appealed
to the Supreme Court of the State of Illinois, where it was heard in April of 1906. The unanimous decision was written by Justice Guy Scott.
Another verdict has now been returned, which also is in favor of the respondents. We have examined the evidence heard by the fourth unanimous jury and deem it unnecessary to discuss the same. The findings of the jury is against the clear preponderance thereof, and for that reason, the verdict must be set aside. The verdict of the jury is set aside, and the Circuit Court of Madison County is directed to
submit the issues to another jury
and to proceed in accordance with the law in this opinion and the earlier opinions of this court in this cause.
At the seventh jury trial in the Circuit Court of Madison County in 1907, a jury of 12 returned a unanimous verdict
exonerating the Alton officials
of violating any Illinois statutes.
This verdict was
appealed
to the Supreme Court of the State of Illinois, where it was heard in April of 1908. Justice Cartwright, who wrote the majority opinion of the Supreme Court's 1904 decision, once again wrote the opinion for the majority.
This proceeding was commenced by the filing in this court of the petition of Scott Bibb for a writ of mandamus commanding the mayor and common council of the city of Alton to admit Minnie Bibb and Ambrose Bibb, children of the relator, to the Washington School, or the most convenient of the public schools to which they had a right to be admitted, without excluding either of them on account of their color or descent. Now, the case has been again tried, and a verdict in favor of the officials, unsupported by any evidence, has been returned to this court for a fifth time. The evidence was for all intents and purposes the same as upon the former trials, and demonstrated beyond the possibility of a doubt that the children of Mr. Bibb were excluded from the Washington School, and that the exclusion was solely on account of their race and color. At the conclusion of the evidence, the attorney for Mr. Bibb moved the trial court to direct a verdict, finding the issues in favor of the relator. But that court denied the motion and refused to give the instruction. In so doing, the trial court erred, and the error wasn't a matter of law, and contrary to the law in this case, as declared by this court in previous opinions filed in the case.
Justice Scott, who wrote the opinion favorable to Scott Bibb's petition in his 1906 appeal, this time dissented, along with Justice Farmer. Scott wrote the dissenting opinion.
We regard the opinions filed in this case prior to the foregoing as correctly stating the law. We dissent from the judgment now entered because we believe this court is without power to render that judgment in the absence of the verdict of a jury in favor of the relator. And we do not join in the criticisms of judges and jurors found in the majority opinion.
The attorney for the officials says we ought to approve this verdict for the reason that the questions of fact have been tried seven times in a circuit court, and all the trials have been presided over by learned judges. We would be remiss in our duty to enforce the law and would forfeit the respect of all law-abiding citizens if we should approve this verdict for no other reason than because it is one of a series which represent not the enforcement of law or the discharge of duty, but a deplorable disregard for the law and for the rights of citizens. These verdicts were pronounced not by those who were avowed enemies of law and government, but those who constituted a part of the governmental machinery for the enforcement of the law and who had been sworn to discharge their duty in that regard.
The right of the respondents to a trial by jury has been five times solemnly recognized by this court, and the existence of that right is expressly shown by the words of the opinion. To now deny this right with a writ of mandamus from this court because juries have persisted in returning verdicts that were not supported by the evidence is, we think, simply to make a bad matter worse.
The error of the court in refusing to direct a verdict is not obviated by the fact that there have been so many verdicts contrary to the law and the evidence. The verdict must be set aside, and the next question is whether the issues shall be again sent to the circuit court for trial.
In this case, the Alton officials seem to have enjoyed a right to a provisional or experimental trial by jury. That is to say, if the jury had found for Mr. Bibb, The officials would not have been deprived by this court of the right to a jury trial. But inasmuch as the jury found the other way, the verdict is set aside, and the judgment of this court is entered against the respondents without a verdict to support it.
Great weight is justly given to the conclusion of a jury upon controverted questions of fact, where the verdict appears to be the result of an honest exercise of judgment, and the weighing with fair deliberation of the credibility of witnesses. But it is beyond dispute that this verdict does not represent any conclusion of the jury from the evidence, and that all of the verdicts represent nothing but a refusal by juries to enforce a law which they do not personally approve or which is distasteful to them.
If the majority regard the juries that can be obtained in Madison County and the judges who preside in the circuit court in that county as unfitted by prejudice to try the questions of fact, this court possesses the undoubted power to submit the same issues for trial to the circuit court of any other county in the state.
We are of the opinion that it would be wrong to the relator to further delay him in establishing his rights and to compel him to add to the trouble and expense already incurred. The verdict of the jury is set aside, and the issues will not be again certified to the circuit court for trial, but will now be finally disposed of. We therefore find that all the material facts alleged in the petition are true as therein stated, and that Mr. Bibb is entitled to a writ of mandamus as requested. And it is therefore ordered that a peremptory writ of mandamus issue according to the petition, that the respondents pay the costs, and that execution issue therefore. Writ awarded.
Father?
Yes, Minnie?
What happened?
You're going back to school.
25 African-American students apply for enrollment to reintegrate Alton schools.
But Alton's city attorney interprets the Supreme Court's writ narrowly, applying only to the children named in the petition.
Ambrose Bibb.
And Minnie Bibb.
Even Scott Bibb's younger children were denied admission to the white school.
Ambrose Bibb, now 21, had already left Alton.
Though the Alton High School has remained integrated throughout this time, the school officials require Minnie Bibb be given an academic examination.
Minnie Bibb, now 19, is assigned to the third grade classroom.
With children half her age.
The grade she would have entered in September of 1897, when police officers turned her away from the door.
After a short period of attendance, faced with hostility from her teacher and the children in her classroom, Minnie Bibb left Washington School.
And the Alton schools were once again segregated.
Scott Bibb organizes another boycott.
But the parents at the Douglas School refused to take part.
The Alton Evening Telegraph runs articles vilifying Scott Bibb with claims that his efforts have left Minnie Bibb without education.
In response to a race riot in Springfield, Illinois that year, the Evening Telegraph reports that vicious elements of both races are plotting that Alton may be next.
Just 2 days later in Alton, a white mob saying a black man threw stones at a white screams they will Springfield him.
Articles in the white Alton Evening Telegraph allege that ministers of black churches advise their congregations that separate schools are sensible, providing safety along with employment for more African-American teachers.
Whites in Alton offer to buy school supplies for children attending the colored schools.
And soon, students began to fill the Lovejoy School.
By the end of that September, half of the African school-aged children are back in segregated schools.
Eventually, the Board of Education opens segregated annexes in the white McKinley and Washington schools to allay the objection of blacks to sending their children to distant schools.
Scott Bibb denied the equal access that the Illinois Supreme Court ruled his family deserved, finally relents, and enrolls his younger children at the segregated Washington Annex.
When Reverend Elijah Lovejoy's body was prepared for burial, William Johnson, a free black, stained his simple casket with pokeberries.
Beginning a tradition in which the black citizens of Alton would continue to care for the crusaders' resting place, Johnson dug the grave in a hidden area near Lovejoy's home, marked with only a plain wooden board to protect it from being discovered and desecrated by rioters.
In recognition of Reverend Lovejoy's sacrifice and his resolve in continuing to publish his paper, although press after press was destroyed, the monument to his memory rises above Alton as a reminder of the city's historic role in the struggle for justice.
Scott Bibb and the African-American community that joined him showed the same resolve. Returning to the courtroom again and again, rejected by jury after jury, before finally winning his case before the highest court in the state of Illinois, only to lose again at the hands of elected government officials. But Scott Bibb's story was lost for decades, only recently restored by the work of historians. Not even a photograph of Bibb has been located, and no monument celebrated his name until February 10th. 2015, when the Board of Trustees of Lewis and Clark Community College celebrated his courage by renaming the Adult Community Learning Center on East 5th Street in Alton, Illinois, as the Scott Bibb Center.
In 1950, 4 years before the seminal case of Brown versus the Board of Education, wherein the United States Supreme Court overturned the separate but equal doctrine of Plessy versus Ferguson, the Alton branch of the NAACP organized a campaign in which 150 African American students attempted to register at the city's white schools, finally leading to the return of integrated classrooms over 50 years after Scott Bibb organized the boycott.
Justice Cartwright wrote in his 1908 opinion, "When the law, through the refusal of jurors to regard their oaths, becomes impotent to protect the rights of the humblest, the rights of no person are secure."
The African Americans of the Alton Citizens Committee and the Ladies Committee showed their respect for the law by using the legal means afforded them by the Constitution and statutes of Illinois to attempt to remedy their grievances. 7 juries rejected their petition.
Jurors may take heed that they obey and enforce the law, lest their refusal to enforce the law for the protection of others become effective to deprive them of their legal rights and substitute the beliefs of jurors and courts as to the wisdom of laws enacted for their protection.
Despite the valiant efforts of Scott Bibb and the 5 favorable decisions from the Illinois Supreme Court, the system failed to protect the rights of his children and to provide them justice.
100 years later, how are we doing? Thank you very much.